We're back from the Transamerica Trail, and now it's time to do some reviews on our equipment. The bike that you choose for the TAT depends mainly on the route that you want to take. For our trip, we wanted to hit the more aggressive trails, and for that reason, we chose the Honda CRF 450 RL. So check out our previous videos. Yeah. And if that's the type of riding that you want to do on the TAT, then the Honda CRF 450 RL, it really is the perfect bike for the trip. And any other bike in that class would do well also. The Husky 501, the KTM 500, any bike in that class would be a good choice for the trip. Check out this video for a summary of the modifications that we've made to the bikes. Now let's dive into the bikes.
Tire on it. Nice and easy through here.
All right, so we've done a lot of mods, but when it came down to it, when the rubber meets the road, there's really only two that were critical and one that we really highly recommend. And the rest are just like quality of life. So the first one is the Seat Concept seat. Drastic improvement in comfort over the stock, and when you're spending a long day in the saddle, really made a world of difference. The second critical mod that we did was the gas tank. And the reason we call this critical is because we just don't want to carry that much extra fuel in the back of the bike. And once we got out west, there were many, many days where we basically sucked the 3 gallon dry. And even we were carrying a little bit of reserved gas, but we used every bit of what was in the tank just between the closest gas stations. And then the other two modifications are really highly recommended. They really improved like the quality of our trip, but I wouldn't call them super essential. The first is the Vortex ECU. So basically the stock bike has a really twitchy throttle, and this eliminates that and just makes it overall more responsive and less flame out issues, improvements across the board. And then in combination with that, we have the Yoshimura RS4 exhaust system. And these two together not only give you much better characteristics of the bike, but you also get a lot more power out of it as well. So it's a very nice mod to have there.
All right, now let's talk about tires.
So on our trip, we ended up going through 3 rear tires and 2 front tires on both bikes. We started with the classic combination, the D606 in the rear and the Pirelli MT21 on the front. Ended up at Trinidad, kind of just took what we could get our hands on, ended up getting a Metzler 6-Day Extreme on the rear and a Kenda K270 on the front. And then in Salt Lake, we smoked through the Metzler already, so we went ahead and got the Kenda K270 for the rear as well. So in summary, the D606 and MT21 really is the combination. If we had to do this trip again, I would run that tire combination the entire way. It really provides the best combination between traction on pavement as well as like anything once it starts to get pretty nasty, whether that be sand, mud, dirt, rock, whatever. Just for reference, here's the MT21 front with respect to the Kenda K270 that's currently on the bikes. So yeah, the MT21's a lot more aggressive. And this is a D606, so this is the type of tire we started the trip on. And this is the Kenda K270 we ended the trip on. And for a view of the Metzler, check out this video. So in summary, I already mentioned the Pirelli Dunlop combination really is the best. However, we were pleasantly surprised with most of the other tires. Yeah, so it was from day, I believe it was 17 on, we ran the K270 in the front and had it through some pretty nasty stuff and was pleasantly surprised with how it did. Luckily, we didn't have any mud days, so I think that's where it really would have struggled. But when in anything dry, we really kind of enjoyed the tire, actually. It did decent. The Metzler 6-Day Extreme, great tire. Hooked up great in the hard stuff and felt okay on the road. Problem with it is that we blew through it in like 1,000 miles. So that was a bummer. And then last but not least is the Kenda K270. And we really like that tire on the road, sticks well, but off-road, it's very lackluster.
All right, luggage. The luggage system that we chose was a Wolfman, and we used the E-Base with the large rolly bags, 3 large rolly bags. This system worked very well. It was pretty easy to get on and off the bike, and in the evenings, we would take the whole thing off and just take it in the hotel with us, just 3 straps and it's off. So very easy to access, had plenty of storage for us. We got everything we needed in these 3 bags.
Okay. Ooh. Should have pulled this. There we go. I think I'm good. I can just do what we did with yours.
Also put a rack on the back, which made it easier to strap the Wolfman to and to put our extra fuel container and some other odds and ends on. One system we tried before the TAT was the Tusk Highland, and this is a very high quality system, very well made and a good system, but for the 450 that we're on, it hangs down too far and it gets in the way of your feet and it's just not comfortable to ride with. So we did not use this system. And I would recommend this system on a bigger bike, but not on the 450.
All right, so a couple of the things that we would definitely change about our luggage setup is the backpack and the tank bag. So the backpack, really, really like the backpack, but it's just the problem of having that much weight on your shoulders for that long. So to do it over, we would definitely get like an USWE or a Camelback, like just a small, like 2-liter, 3-liter hydration bladder and nothing else on your back to just relieve the weight. And then the tank bag is nice if you're just on the road, but if you're off road and you need to be moving around on the seat, it really becomes in the way. Yeah, so one of the bummers with the backpack is you hit your luggage a lot, and again, it's just a lot of weight on your shoulders, so it's hurting your back.
This luggage is not full right now. This is pretty empty. When we were on the trip, this was full and was really hitting your backpack's hitting it all the time.
Right, so if you do have a backpack, a lot of the times you are better off to take it off and just strap it to the back. And the last thing is this tank bag. So if you're trying to get up on the seat, you know, and get through a corner, you can't. And as you know, getting up far on the seat's pretty important when you're riding. But if you go without a tank bag, all of a sudden you have so much extra space. So if you need to get up in a hairy section on top of the tank, you really can. So in hindsight, doing the trip over, we would get rid of the tank bag.
Yeah, if you're gonna do the aggressive trails, ditch the tank bag.
All right, on to the gear. We talked a little bit about the backpack situation, but let's dive a little deeper and talk about protection and the other outerwear we wore. So on this trip, we went through several evolutions of gear. Really took us a while to narrow down on what works best. And so for me, it all starts with the base layer. So every single day I wore these Dick's Sporting Goods hot weather base layers. I got the 3/4 length pants, which are really nice because they come down and over your knee pads and keep your knees from chafing up from those. And the corresponding shirt to go with it, just to keep, you know, any agitation or irritation away from your skin. And also it breathes really well, and if it gets wet, dries quickly, keeps you cool. Directly on top of those, I wear just standard motocross pants and a motocross jersey in combination with these Alpinestars knee pads. And I really like these just because they're pretty light in the back and they vent very well and keep you cool. On top of my jersey, I wear a chest protector, and this was a lifesaver for me, especially following Dad a lot, because any of the stuff he kicks up really hurts at 60 miles an hour. And plus, if you do go down, it is some protection there. So that was a big deal for me. And I preferred this over body armor a lot on this trip because the body armor was a little bit constrictive, a little bit hotter, but largely it's so much more to deal with to take on and off if you want to stop somewhere. Versus this, super quick, super easy, ready to roll. So then on top of the chest protector, if it wasn't super hot, if it was just like kind of a normal day riding, I wore this Leatt jacket on top of it. The Leatt GPX 4.5 Lite. And it's nice and breathable, but still pretty stiff. So if you're going 70 miles an hour down the interstate, it holds up pretty well and doesn't beat you to death too bad. And lots of vents in the sleeves zip off as well for different, you know, heat options basically. And then on the head, of course, we have the Arai XD4. Super solid helmet. Everyone uses it. And it is Snell and DOT certified. So overall, a really good helmet. Definitely recommend it, even for the price. Besides, if you go down, kind of want your head protected. Don't want to save a couple $100 and have an injury that could have been prevented. And the other thing that we did with the helmets is we put the PackTalk Slim communication system in it. And me and Dad use these to talk. Overall, really good and highly recommend. If I had to do over though, I may have gotten the not the slim version, the one that goes on the outside of the helmet, just because this kind of makes it a little harder to get the helmet on and off. But again, very minor deal. Didn't really have a problem with it. Just kind of a personal preference thing. Then for the feet, Dad and I have both really fell in love with the Alpinestars like Tech series. Dad wears the Tech 7s. I wore the Tech 3s. Recently upgraded to the Tech 5s, but any of those boots we've really, really enjoyed and wouldn't trade them for anything. And then on top of all this, the last thing is like, how do you carry your hydration? And on the trip, I used this big backpack, but in hindsight, I would swap that out for like this USWE or a Camelback, any type of smaller pack that only does hydration. A lot thinner, a lot lighter, a lot less weight on your shoulders. And then to complete it all, to cover the rain situations and the cold weather, we have just a basic rain jacket packed up that I carry with me. So you can throw this on anytime it rains and corresponding rain pants. And also a nice packable puffy. So if it does get cold, you can just throw this on underneath everything and maybe even throw your rain jacket on too if you really want some warmth and good in pretty much any conditions. And for me, having this layer-based system ended up being a lot better than like one dedicated Gore-Tex jacket with a bunch of zippers, just because like the days in the desert when it got very hot, it was super nice to be able to take everything off and have just like my jersey and a chest protector and stay cool.
Woo. All right, so my setup was very similar to Jake's. Pretty much same boots, same helmet, everything very, very similar. The only difference was with my jacket. So I used the Klim Carlsbad jacket. And this jacket has built-in elbow protection, and you can see right there it did its job at one point. It's got a built-in back protector, and it's a nice thick Gore-Tex type material. It's waterproof, so for me this was a good option, because every time we stop, taking it on and off was quick and easy. I didn't have to fool with body armor or anything like that. A little bit hot on the hotter days. A couple days I just took it off and strapped it to the back of the bike and just wore my motocross jersey if it got too hot. So for me, good option, Klim Carlsbad. We also have a lot to say about route selection. We're gonna save that for a different video. So be sure to like and subscribe and drop us a comment down below.
Wow, they have returned. Looking just as they did when we loaded them up. How long did it take, Dad?
It took a good solid month to get here.
Yep, not the quickest. Yep, Federal Motorcycle Transport did a good job.